Hello, welcome to PSAS Fall Orientation. I am Rose, one of the project managers.
Rose, what's your major?
Psychology and mechanical engineering.
Cool. Yeah. So I'm Aiden. I'm also one of the other project managers. I major in business management and leadership. But you know, the business school is really far away from here, so I usually come over here, stay the night, and you know, try to get stuff done.
So what is Portland State Aerospace Society? So we are a group, a huge interdisciplinary group, people from all over, and we build rocket satellites and this is doing. So we started in 1998, and we're completely student-led, open source. We pretty much build all of our own stuff, we want to make better students through hands-on interdisciplinary projects. So these are some of the things that we got going on.
So since we're, you know, a big organization, we have a lot of disciplines as shown by our other slides just before, we need to have like, you know, a vision statement, something that unites us all under one common goal. And that's why in our vision statement, we are dedicated to building a one-ton tungsten rod orbital kinetic bombardment system. I'm sorry, that's the wrong slide. I'm so sorry. That's my other group project. Yeah. This is actually our vision statement. So we are dedicated to putting a 1 kilogram nanosatellite into orbit based on our own rocket. Now, it might seem, you know, a bit hard, and it actually is. We need a lot of funds to actually reach this kind of capabilities. We need like millions of dollars, something we have not been able to do over 24 years, and probably not going to do it in 50 either. But we are still going to try it anyway. And a common misconception is that people think, oh, reaching like, you know, suborbital is, you know, the hardest part is to get off Earth. Actually, that's not true. Orbital, reaching orbital velocity and staying in orbit is the hardest part. And we will showcase more of that with the satellites later. So as I mentioned, we're going to still try it anyway, because if we didn't try on hard things, we'll be banging our heads and banging rocks together in caves. And we actually still kind of do that. We don't bang rocks anymore. We bang metals. We bang electricity. We bang wires. And so this is our three strategic projects, such as our launch vehicles, our nano satellites, and our liquid fuel engines.
So I want to go back to the orbital plate for just a minute. So I just want to emphasize what Aiden was saying. One more, which is any student group that says they're going to make something that goes into orbit is dumb or lying, one of the two. And so we like to say that you need literally more metric tons of lawyers and fuel to get to orbit, right? And you also need, what you said, a couple million dollars, and you need a giant infrastructure. It's inconceivable that a student group would put something into orbit. However, it's a cool problem, right? And if someone gave us a ton of lawyers, metric, and a couple million dollars in a launch facility, we'd go to orbit. Sure, that's fine. But as a vision statement, we don't expect to get there, but it's a cool problem. And we can actually take our group and do all the problems that we want to do around that vision statement in mind.
Absolutely. So moving on, we have Rose here introduce our first amateur rockets.
Okay. So for our first project, we work on amateur rockets. This is sort of a history of our rocket iterations. Down at the end is LV1, and then up here is LV4. LV4 is not on. We need to add LV4. LV3.1 is this one on the top here. LV4 is down at the bottom. LV3 is the one we're going to be, 3.1 is the one we're going to be launching in April, and LV4 is the one that we are currently kind of in the design phases of, and that's the one that we hope to launch today.
So here's a little video of our LV2.3, so this is the iteration before the LV3.1, and this is just showcasing how it does its roll control.
So we're going to use the word interdisciplinary way too many times. I think it should be a drinking game. And the reason why we do is because nothing, if it's not interdisciplinary, it's not interesting. So this is an amateur rocket built by mechanical engineers with a control system made by electrical engineers running code written by a CF major. And what it's doing right now is it's sensing what the spin rate is and controlling the spin rate. And play it one more time, actually. What's happening, those little black things on the top, those are called canards. And the red is the control authority and the yellow is the spin rate. And what we're doing is we're doing 90 degree snap rolls every like 5 seconds or 10 seconds or something. And then at one point we run out of steam. This is Central Oregon. So we've done all 13 of our launches in Central Oregon, about 45 minutes east of Bend. We go out there with a lot of other people who launch amateur rockets. We spend Friday night doing star partying with telescopes, which is really fun because it's really dark sky. And then we blow shit up the next day. And sometimes it works like this.
This is our one of our past launches, is a 360 video. Kind of move it down, as you can see. Nice little view. Probably obliterated by the rockets, Harrison.
Look down, you can see the small button.
There we go. And black pixels.
So that's us right there. That's the launch line. We're safely far away, so when it explodes, they don't die. It turns out that killing undergraduate students is really frowned on.
But not graduate students.
Residents. Yeah, you guys know what you signed up for. So that's about 30,000 feet. So sorry, this one is left. This is about 20,000 feet. So we're underneath a jet airliner, right? So we're not even near space. But for this rocket, that wasn't the point. But this rocket was kind of a test bed for can we build an avionics system that can control the roll control and send telemetry down, have a GPS receiver, and have it actually work. So the rocket was flying, well,
So here we're going to have our launch vehicle projects. We're going to have Jay, our current ERS lead, talk more about that.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jay. I'm a mechanical engineering major. With PSAS, the airframe team lead, currently handling airframe stuff, plus also the ERS. Over the summer, I was an intern with PSAS and primarily worked on the ERS. RCS, the coal gas roll control system, is a little vacant at the moment, but that's where some of you guys come in to kind of take over some of the projects that come from there.
Jay, what is the ERS? What is it stand for? What does it
do? The ERS is the electromechanical recovery system. Its job is to pretty much deploy the parachute. Without it, you have a really big, expensive lawn dart.
And those are
nah.
Yeah, who would have thought? my job was to come up with a system along with other discipline.
Made a thing that works, and
it's really cool. If you want to look at it,
we'll have a tour later tonight, and I'd be more than happy to show it off.
And no pressure, but Jay's system doesn't work in rocket crashes, which is very exciting. And we'll fly it this April. And again, he's a dirty mechanical student, but the cool electrical engineering kid are working on the embedded system board that runs his system. And then hopefully we'll get some CS folks to do the programming for that board. They're getting interdisciplinary project.
And this is an LV3.1. We'll be launching in April. Oh, that is LV3 right there. Won't be LV3.1, hopefully. we launched it in April. Pretty much done with PDRS. That's kind of like our biggest bottleneck right now for fabricating a lot of stuff. But again, we're almost there. We like to think that LV3.1 serves as a bit of a test bed. Anything that we develop for LV3.1, we hope that we can then scale up for LV4. We might have a cool idea for LV4, and we'll try it on LV3.1, and if it blows up, then probably a bad idea.
And what you're looking at right here was our first attempt at launch vehicle number 3. This is 3.0. This is why we're working on 3.1. You can say it didn't go very well. And it was a really interesting failure. And for the mechanical engineers who want to know about aeroelastic bending and over-optimizing an airframe, we can show you some pretty bits of shattered carbon fiber and rocket. But we learned interesting things that we did not learn before.
Yeah, of course.
So our next project is liquid fuel engines.
Do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah.
Great. We don't really have a liquid fuel engine team yet. That's Andrew's job right there. All the rockets you've seen so far have a big solid fuel motor that we can buy commercially speaking. It's about $2,000, and you put it in there and you light it and you run, because once it's lit, you can't stop it, right? But it turns out if we're gonna make that 100-kilometer rocket, if we're gonna go for LV4, which we'll talk about in a minute, we really need a different kind of engine, an engine we can control. And so that's a liquid fuel engine. And so that's liquid oxygen and isopropyl alcohol. And so we've had multiple mechanical engineering capstones design a liquid fuel engine, regenerative cooled. So we actually blow the fuel through the engine to cool it down. And then we even had multiple ME and EE capstones working on liquid fuel engine test stand, which you'll see in the rocket building. And this is just too goddamn hard. This is like almost 5 years worth of work. We still don't know what we're doing. We're still gonna explode things. So Andrew's job and his capstone team is to put together what we call the mini test stand, which is to put together a really, really small version of this so that we can onboard people on the liquid fuel engine and then work on the big projects that we'll need for future. For you physics majors, it's too bad we don't have any math majors, because this is how we get the math majors. One of the things that we really do is that we try and do everything best practices, right? And this multidisciplinary design optimization is getting math people together to simulate the trajectory of the rocket so that the rocket designs that we do are not awful. They're minimum weight and all that kind of stuff. And so if you're into simulation and Python and things like that, the MDO is going to make it
harder to do
that.
Yeah. Hello. My name is Andrew. I'm part of the PSAS propulsion group, and I'm the team lead on the MINST project. Together, me and my group of six will build PSAS's first liquid fueled engine and the test stand necessary to live fire the rocket. Now, this is a big deal. We've been trying to do this for the last 4 years. The MINST project aims to safely bring rocket science to students across Oregon and inspire future engineers. PSAS and my team are very excited at the possibilities, hopefully funding, that the MINST project will bring to the society and university. If any of you are interested and are PSU seniors, feel free to talk to me for your question. Thank you very much.
So our next project, we build CubeSats.
So we build CubeSats, as many of you know. We have built Oregon's first satellite. So Oregon's first satellite is ORSAT 0. Why did we name it 0 and not 1? I still don't know. But either way, we launched it back in March 15 on the Astro rocket off the coast of Alaska. And we launched it upwards into low Earth orbit, 525 kilometers. Down to the sun synchronous orbit. We want to thank spaceflight a lot. They're our Pacific Northwest local launch company, and they helped us with the ride. So this was taken at T minus, I think, 5 seconds, before the launch, with the water sound suppression system online over there. The day before, we actually had another launch. This one you see here was the backup launch window. The day before, we were all gathered around the rocket room at the meeting table, and we were all praying as soon as that weather alert, hit us saying, oh, we got 70% chance we can't launch today. We were all praying for a goddamn lightning bolt to hit the rocket and blow it up, because it would have been so PSAS and so Portland of it. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. So we launched it in space. That's the next best thing. Now, this picture was taken at, T plus 4 minutes and 20 seconds. Nothing in time, but it showcases our, this second stage of the rocket in low Earth orbit and Ortsat Zero being on, in it. So we use Cesium. Cesium is one of the programs we monitor. It shows where our satellite is at all times. Every day or so, it passes over Oregon. Every 3 days or so, it passes over Portland. It gets a very good pass at that time. But what did Ortsat Zero bring us? Because it, at the end of the day, was kind of a flight heritage. We were just kind of building it to test it, see if we can prove that we, as a space kind of college group, can build a satellite. And the answer is yes, we can. So we have our next one coming up, Ortsat 0.5. So we're expecting to hand it off around November of this year and then launch it on SpaceX's Transporter 7 sometime in February next year. And unlike our other projects, we are kind of hopeful we can actually make the deadline this one. And finally, our big boy, Ortsat 1. So that one will be launched from the ISS in sometime in 2024, hopefully. And that has a couple of very interesting subsystems that we're working towards. One of the subsystems is called the CFC, or the Cirrus Flux Camera. It's not here. So the CFC itself is kind of a camera that will monitor cirrus flux clouds in the atmosphere and showcase how global warming and other climate changes affect this clouds and also our climate patterns. The other one that we like a lot more is known as the 10 kilometer selfie stick, because what we'll do is we will strap a live stream camera to this guy here and then launch it into space. So every time it passes over Oregon and passes over Portland, we can help you build a handheld ground system. It's very simple. All you need to do is just connect your phone to it, and then you can live stream yourself on space. How cool is that? So, but back to CubeSats. We have our main projects here, which I'll let Andrew take over for the structure, bus, software, and much more.
So the CubeSat is its own large project. And so if you're a mechanical engineer, there's thermal and vibration and structural work to do on the CubeSat. For electrical engineers, there's power and attitude control and communications. For the software side of stuff, there's a ton of software, and we are desperate for computer science people to help us write Python code in Linux and embedded Linux and embedded C for ORSAT, and not just the one that's in space, but the one that's coming up and the one that's coming up after that. This is a whole open source CubeSat development kit. It's not just us that's using it, but other universities that are interested in using our stuff as well.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. One other university is looking to purchase an ORSAT from us. So now on to the UniClock ground station.
Okay, so up on the roof of this here building, we have our very own ground station called UniClock. Its job is to hopefully talk to our satellites, which is also a project.
But it's another computer science, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering project of many.
So business and project management. I'm just skipping right on.
So I'm the financial director for PSAS, also the program manager. So in project management right now, we are extremely critical. We need a lot of people, but that is kind of a talk better suited for the business orientation. I know most of you here are science-y folks, so I would be a complete idiot to talk more about this. And I was just going to say, we do business.
That's what I'm trying to say. We do business. We have the business sector, finance sector, and the outreach sector. And I do want to clarify that even today, if you are a sciencey person, you're in engineering, comp sci, math, physics, or whatnot, you can still work as leadership. You can still work as any of these roles I put on here. And they're not exhaustive. There are a lot more. But again, we can dive deeper into that after the orientation. So now we also talk about the associated organization.
All right, so we're associated with a variety of organizations. AIAA, we have our own chapter of that. IEEE, DED USA, several of us are co-chairs. We're hoping to go to a conference coming up here soon in the next month and a half. And We in Space is sort of an arm outreach to Portland State. And we promote diversity and inclusion in aerospace. That's kind of one of our goals. We are chapters of WOAA and SWIFE, the Women's Astronautics and Aeronautics, and Society for Women Engineers. And so we do STEM outreach. We hold aerospace speaker series. What was really cool, we had Dr. Soyoung Yi, who was one of South Korea's first astronauts. She's super cool. And Nagin Cox, who worked on the NASA's Mars rovers. There we go. That's really exciting. There's just lots of opportunities for stuff like that. We've got people who've had internships and placements from all over. Several of the people from our group have become our Goins fellows, among other fellowships. We've had people place at Lockheed Martin, Blue Origin, a lot of places.
So we're
45 now. Is it 45 now? I thought it was 35. Oh, 45 it is. Cool. Your future is interesting. Because we need help. So we have a variety of engineering roles. Again, this is not exhaustive, also. The bold ones are, of course, are areas that we need a little bit more help in. So mechanical, electrical, computer science, systems, really everybody from all over. And so management roles?
Yes. So for management, we won't dive too deeply into this, but if you're interested in any of the particular outreach or doing grant writing, a lot of engineers and comsci people sort of do grant writing at the same time. It looks great on your resume. It also helps you with your capstone or your project. And we also have other kind of managements, if you're interested in it.
Okay, so there's a lot of other things that you can do while you're here hanging out with them. So you can do a Rockets 101 workshop, which is what some of us are. I'm taking some of these guys out to get certified this weekend, which is really exciting. We're going to spend a weekend in the desert. It's going to be great. It's been cold too. Anyway, don't get lost. People build their own rocket kits and they go and they get certified, hopefully. We try to prepare people as much as possible for that. We do low power builds before we do a high power build. We'll be going through at some point in time this week the open rocket workshop for those who are certifying. And then we also have amateur radio license workshops. We just had one of those this last weekend. It was pretty cool. And then you spend pretty much a day and a half doing class stuff, and then you'll go and take a test. And then you'll be able to, be a cool secret space star.
So for my story here, I obviously am the odd one, kind of the odd one out here with business. I know there's maybe a couple over here, but my story of joining PSAS is not your traditional way of coming to the orientation. So I met PSAS at the business mixer, which is something that PSU Business School hosts like every year, I don't know, every term. And when I went to the business mixer, I was like, wow. They have free food. That's actually the reason I went. And then I went there, I was munching my burrito, and then I saw PSAS in the corner with rockets. And I was like, wow, they got rockets. So I went over there and talked to them. And after a year or so, talking with the other management teams and working with every interdisciplinary folk, now I'm here.
So my story is I'm gonna try and keep it short. So a long time ago, I used to work in surgery, and I decided that wasn't necessarily for me, even though I still think it's interesting. Then I decided to go back and get interested. I got interested in neuroscience and started doing that with psychology, and that's how I ended up here. It's because I was snooping around in the engineering web, but see if there's any neuroscience around here. And everybody happens to have a side interest in neuroscience. So that's how I ended up here. And I helped people move stuff from a garage my first weekend. And the next thing you know, I'm getting certified, and now I live here. I've been able to kind of tie in what I was doing with neuroscience into space. And I was really fortunate to be able to present for the Oregon NASA Space Grant Consortium, which is really cool. My project was on spaceflight-associated neuroocular syndrome and ways to mitigate the effects for long-duration spaceflight to Mars. It's a mouthful. That's kind of what happened. And I've been on project management while I've been finishing my psych degree, which is done now. And now I can switch to mechanical. So, yeah. That's kind of my story. Who else wants
to stand up? I'm going to start calling names.
Weston?
Mm-hmm.
No?
Alex?
Someone who's
okay.
Relatively
new.
Say hi.
Yeah.
Hello. You.
Right. Tell us about Orion and how you got involved.
I was on the PDX, like general computer science Slack channel, and somebody posted in there about an internship opportunity, and I was looking. Had a meeting with Andrew and got involved. It's been great. So I'm a computer science graduate student. And I'm working on ground station software. It's great. I've had stuff for my resume, got an open source project going there. So it's, my first like actual experience sort of in industry, a really good opportunity for me professionally. And it's just been fun all around.
Thank you for coming. Let's thank our presentation. And if you have questions, we're going to give tours of the rocket room. Also, to be both online, are we doing breakout rooms?
Yeah, so we'll do breakout rooms after the tour. So if everyone wants to, come over to the rocket room, we'll begin to give tours. And also, if you have not signed up yet, please do scan the QR code to fill out the new form. And thank you for listening to our presentation.
Enough for just a minute.
So, the way to get involved, like I said before, you're going to hit the brick learning curve wall. Is go sign up for this. This will make you send an email that. You don't even have to, it's just a blank email. You'll get an autoresponder with the link. And that link is a Google form to fill out, which is the new member agreement. So if you're interested in working with us or even just hanging out, fill that out. We'll throw you on Slack. That's how we communicate fast and agilely, right? And then eventually we'll share the Google Drive with you where we have a lot of our documentation. And then just start showing up to whatever meeting sounds most interesting to you. So if you're a computer science person and you want to work on Linux on a satellite, then you start showing up to the satellite meeting. If you're interested in the liquid fuel engine, then you start showing up to the propulsion meetings. And you'll see that all on our Google Calendar that's on the PDX Aerospace site. So just start showing up. And eventually, in a year or two, you'll have your own project, your own satellite, you'll have car key access to everywhere, and you'll have no sleep, but you'll then be hired immediately, and then we'll curse your name. Because of all the experience that you've gotten in the last couple of years, you'll leave and go into the aerospace and get a good job. But that's okay, because then we'll tithe you for the next 10 years, because you'll feel so guilty about leaving us that you'll give us money back and finish. So that's it. Hang around, talk to all of us. Raise your hand if you're an older PSAS person. Raise your hand. Yeah, no, come on, get it. Yeah, that's fine. So talk to these people. Too as well. They're not just Rose and Aiden. There's enough people around here to just kind of figure out who's who and what's what and what is interesting to work on and all that stuff. So thank you.